A very good evening to one and all. We are back with our Rao Hospital's pregnancy web series. We do this every Saturday at 4 p.m. Last week, we spoke about preconceptional care. And this week, we're going to be talking about the first trimester of pregnancy. Okay. We had a very interesting session last time. We had a lot of questions and answers. We had Dr. Suganya, one of my colleagues who spoke last time. This time, we have Dr. Preeti with us, who will be talking to us in detail. So whatever doubts you have, anything that you have questions, please drop it in the chat box and we're very happy to take your questions. And today we're mainly going to be talking about the first trimester of pregnancy. So if you look at pregnancy, it's divided into three parts or three trimesters as such. So the first trimester is the first 12 weeks. And this is very, very important because all the organogenesis is taking place. So all, you know, the small parts of the baby is developing, and any small insult to the baby at this point can be detrimental. Okay, the baby just starts as two small cells, which divides into four cells, 16 cells, 64 cells, and so on and so forth. So all the organs are developing at this part in time, and it's very, very important that you take good care of yourself. And Dr. Preeti, who is my colleague, she's an OBGYN with a special interest in laparoscopy and obstetrics. She'll be taking us through the first trimester of pregnancy, and she'll be talking about all the do's and don'ts during the first trimester. So, Dr. Preeti, on to you.
Good evening, everyone. Actually, the first trimester, as rightly sir said, it is very important because organogenesis is going to take place during this first trimester. First trimester usually starts from the 0 week to 14th week of the pregnancy. Usually 0 week, we won't be knowing when means whether we are pregnant or not, because it is the time which is considered as the last menstrual cycle. We will come to know only after 4 weeks, minimum of after 4 weeks only, we will come to know that whether we are pregnant or not. So once you miss your periods, why we have to consult a doctor? Because that is the olden thought that there is no need to consult a doctor for the first 2 months or 3 months like that. There is an old school of thought among the common among the community, but it is not so. Because once you miss your periods, you have to consult a doctor. That is the main reason is that we can able to triage the high-risk pregnancy and low-risk pregnancy if you are coming early to us, so that we can prevent many maternal complications and many kind of chromosomal defects and genetic and growth abnormalities can be easily dealt with and can be treated with. Means if at all, if it is there, we can be taking the adequate action if it is so in the early weeks of gestation than if you are coming at the later weeks of gestation. And now you will have a doubt. Means what will happen once I miss my periods? What will happen? The most common symptom is amenorrhea, that is missing your periods for a few days or few months. It is called as an amenorrhea. And second is that most common symptom is generalized tiredness. A woman will feel very tired and weak during once she misses her periods. And third one is the nausea, that is the feeling to vomit. She won't vomit, but she will have the feeling to vomit and she will have the vomiting as well. And occasionally she may have some spotting or she might have few drops of blood and she occasionally she can have abdominal cramps or something, feeling of heaviness in her lower abdomen. Once you have, if not all the symptoms are very common, one will have one or two symptoms and the other will have some other. And we might get afraid if we have spotting. But once the placenta is going to get attached, the spotting is more common. So you should not be very fearful about this. If you're having spotting, you can consult your doctor because they will do some necessary hormonal profile or they will do scan to look for certain things so that it can be dealt with ease and care without making a much more problem in the later stage. And the second most common thing is that abdominal cramps. If it is a simple abdominal cramps, you can wait. But if you're having a severe abdominal pain, then you have to consult your doctor immediately, because there is a very rare possibility of ectopic pregnancy, which is also a pregnancy, but the pregnancy won't occur within the uterus. It will occur in the tubes or any other sites other than the uterus. So it is very dreadful and fatal condition to a woman's health. So in that case, if they're having a severe pain abdomen, if she missed her periods, then they have to consult the doctor immediately. It should be taken into account that it is a normal and very common in pregnancy. And the third thing is that nausea and vomiting is common during pregnancy. But if she is having a severe vomiting, that is vomiting continuously, and she's not able to take anything for more than 12 hours, and she's very much dehydrated, she has not passed urines, she's feeling giddiness, if at all these symptoms are there, then she has to consult the doctor and she has to take the adequate care and any kind of antiemetic is needed, or if any with home remedies it is preventing, she can take that, or she has to take some antiemetics, or if necessary, occasionally she may require IV fluids also, that is intravenous fluids also. And once you come to us, what and all we will see and what and all we will do, it is divided into three parts. First is clinical examination and history taking, and second is investigation part, and third one is the scan, and fourth one is that our medication part. And first, history taking and clinical examination. We will ask certain histories, like you are having any previous past medical history or any kind of surgical history, because everything carries its own risk. Because if the woman is a diabetic, then she has to be treated in a separate manner. Like if she is a hypertensive, because the complications of the hypertension has to be kept in the first trimester itself to prevent the fetal complications. And so medical, surgical, and family history is important. And coming to the clinical examination part, once you're coming to us, first and foremost thing we will see is your maternal BMI, that is your weight, and maternal BP. We have to see the blood pressure for a female. These are the two important things we will be seeing. Rest all height, rest all pulse, everything will be seen. But these are all the two important things we will give and key importance. And next, coming to the investigation part, the most common and most wanted investigations are complete blood count, to see how much is the hemoglobin status. That is, the hemoglobin is nothing but then it will depict your red blood cells. So we have to, and WBCs and platelets, we will just screen with that, screen all these things with a complete blood count. And next is the blood grouping and Rh typing. Its importance carries if she is having any negative blood group and she is having excess bleeding, then she might require anti-D immunization. In that case, blood grouping is and Rh typing is important. And in other case, if in case she's having an excess bleeding, the requirement for blood transfusion is there because of excess bleeding or any kind of complications. If blood transfusion requirement is there, then we should not run around. We should know the blood group. So we are done. And next is the TSH. The TSH importance is that the baby's brain development is much more dependent on thyroid hormone. So the level of the thyroid in pregnancy should be kept less than 2.5. So TSH has to be seen. And fourth part is the blood glucose level. Blood glucose level, simply for all the females, we have to do glucose challenge test. That is, we have to give 75 gram of glucose, and after that we will take 2 hour postprandial blood sugar. But if the female is high risk, if they are having family history of diabetes, or if they are having any kind of other risk factor, if they are obese or any other complicating factors, then we have to switch over to HbA1c. That is the 3 months sugar value. This will indirectly or roughly depicts whether she will have a tendency to develop diabetes, because the HbA1c level more than 10, it is advisable to terminate the pregnancy, because it will have a lot of fetal complications. And we have to, and it is better, always better to keep the HbA1c level less than 5.8. In pregnancy, we should maintain a strict blood sugar levels. And in spite of HbA1c, it's always better to see GCT and or GTT, that is glucose tolerance test. We will give a 75 gram of glucose. First, we will take a fasting sample. Then we will give a 75 gram of glucose. After giving 75 gram of glucose, we will take the sugar readings in 1 hour and 2 hour. And the value should be kept, like fasting, it should be less than 100, and 1 hour, it should be less than 150, and 2 hour, it should be less than 100, 120, like that. There are cutoffs there. If there is any change in this cutoff, we have to dealt early by doing the dietary modification, and if required, a small amount of medications. And the final part of the screening investigation part is the screening for infections, that is for screening for HIV and hepatitis B virus and VDRL, that is for syphilis, and urine routine to rule out any kind of urinary tract infection. The next part of investigation is that ultrasound.